Good afternoon. It's my pleasure to welcome you to the University of Washington Tacoma, one of the three campuses of the University of Washington. We are an urban serving campus. We exist because of the efforts of the community who recognize the need for a public institution of higher education. We are therefore of community. We provide education for students from South King County to Olympia. We are research partners in environmental science, community capacity building, cybersecurity, big data, and so on, all in service to community. And we serve to convene conversations around subjects of importance to our community. This is one such example. We have a growing, close partnership with JBLM and Camp Murray. Some might think of the military and academia as somewhat odd partners. Far from it. Both exist to serve a public mission. And the closer one gets to the other, the fewer the stereotypes that survive. Academics might tend to think of military folks as uncritical thinkers, unlikely to challenge a status quo. Hardly so. Military folks might think of academics as disinterested in the world's problems, lost in theory. The more we work together, the more we appreciate the diversity of thought and of action. Bringing diverse viewpoints together in a creative tension is, in fact, what an urban serving university aims to do, with the goal of educating, informing, producing new knowledge and innovation for our communities. President Obama's strategic rebalance toward the Asia-Pacific region is putting a new spotlight on this region and gives us a further opportunity to work together. Working together, we have put together this symposium in partnership, as is our way. We all owe a debt of gratitude to Colonel Dave Johnson and Professor Lisa Hoffman, who is a professor at UW-Tacoma in Urban Studies, and is UW-Tacoma's principal liaison to JBLM, and is a China scholar in her own right. In addition, we have sponsors to thank: Pierce Military and Business Alliance, Tacoma News Tribune, Henry M. Jackson Foundation, and Topia Technology. All are our important sponsors for this symposium. We also thank the National Bureau of Asian Research and the World Affairs Council for help with publicizing the event. We have an illustrious panel, and moderating that panel is our own Professor Divya McMillan. She is a professor in interdisciplinary arts and sciences and director of global honors at the University of Washington, Tacoma. She is associate faculty of the South Asia Center and affiliate faculty of the Center for Global Studies in the Henry M. Jackson School of International Studies at UW Seattle. She is author of the books International Media Studies and Mediated Identities, Youth, Agency, and Globalization, and also the author of over 30 articles and book chapters on globalization. And Professor McMillan last year won the University of Washington Tacoma's Distinguished Research Award. I am very pleased to introduce to you Professor McMillan.
Thank you, Chancellor Friedman. I'm very pleased to be here this evening to guide this conversation on the rebalance to the Asia-Pacific region. The topic is of particular interest to me, so I have to restrain myself from asking all the questions. I have spent my career examining interdependencies forged by globalization, and in my own work have called for a reorientation in global media research to the very areas we're going to focus on today. And although I can't claim to be a foreign policy expert, lately I have been studying soft power as an increasingly relevant facet of foreign policy. I'd like to provide a few brief comments to help get us started. In President Obama's first term, both the President and Secretary of State Hillary Clinton signaled a foreign policy that was more focused on and engaged in the Asia-Pacific region than had been the case in the past decade with U.S. involvements in Iraq and Afghanistan. Originally described as a pivot, Policymakers recently have emphasized that rebalance is more appropriate, as this is not about turning away from other areas, but rather is about a greater investment of the President's time and energy and the United States' resources on the Asia-Pacific. Briefly, the rebalance is defined as a comprehensive, multidimensional strategy that rests on strengthening alliances and deepening partnerships, building a stable and constructive relationship with China, empowering regional institutions, and helping to build a regional economic architecture that can sustain shared prosperity. Concrete examples include, for instance, a mission shift for First Corps at Joint Base Lewis-McChord away from deployments to Iraq and Afghanistan and toward relationship building with counterparts across the Asia-Pacific region. Second, discussions of a new Trans-Pacific partnership that includes trading partners across the region. And third, the formal appointment of a U.S. ambassador to ASEAN, the Association of Southeast Asian Nations. Today, we have four distinguished guests to help us explore the meaning and implications of the rebalance, particularly for Washington State, a state that has a long history of relations and exchanges with the Asia-Pacific region. In bringing these guests together, we have three primary objectives. Our first objective is to educate and inform people about the diversity of exchanges between the state of Washington and the Asia-Pacific region in the context of the President's rebalance policy. Our second objective is to provide an opportunity for conversations across sectors that may not otherwise happen: commerce, the military, academia, and non-governmental organizations. And our third objective is to be innovative and creative in thinking about how we, as a region and as a state, can be proactive in emphasizing the potential benefits from this policy. This might mean new initiatives or partnerships. It might mean new research questions or new support generated for existing and ongoing efforts. So the plan for the conversation, so here's our format. We will begin with the panelists introducing their organizations and their work in relation to this rebalance. I will then pose the first question to the panel. After this topic has been covered by the panel, we will open it up for questions from the audience before moving on to the next question. We ask that you state your name and affiliation before posing your question. We also ask that you are brief in your comments and question, as we will only have a few minutes for questions after each topic. I must also add that we are looking for this to be a dialogue among the panelists themselves, and going by our very invigorating discussion right before we came up on stage, I can tell you that it's going to be a lot of fun. Mr. Malarkey joined the department in 2009, where he oversees the agency's central functions and serves as the senior leader for policy research staff. He represents commerce with business and community interests around the state to help advance the agency's mission to grow and improve jobs in Washington. Prior to joining commerce, Mr. Malarkey worked in clean energy, online marketing at Amazon, and in economic consulting. Welcome. Our next guest is United States Army Major General Jeff Buchanan, and who is the Deputy Commanding General, First Corps at Joint Base Lewis-McChord, Washington. He served four tours of duty in Iraq. From 2003 to 2004, he was Director of Operations, Coalition Military Assistant Training Team, organizing the new Iraqi Armed Forces. From 2004 to 2006, he commanded the 2nd Brigade, 75th Division in Iraq, advising the Iraqi Special Police Commander Division. From 2007 to 2009, he served as Deputy Commanding General for 10th Mountain Division at Fort Drum, including a third deployment to Iraq. He returned for his fourth deployment from 2010 to 2011 as the Director of U.S. Forces Strategic Effects. General Buchanan has been in his current position at Joint Base Lewis-McChord since April 2012. Welcome, General. Our next guest is Beth Riven, who has an MD and MPH and has faculty appointments in the University of Washington Schools of Law, Medicine, and Public Health. Dr. Riven directs the Global Health and Justice Project based at the UW School of Law that collaborates with Seattle-based NGO Uplift International, where she is Vice President of Programs. In addition to numerous publications and other leadership appointments, Dr. Riven has been instrumental in forming a global network of universities launched at the 2012 World Congress of Bioethics, aimed at building clinical and research ethics capacity in medical schools in Asia. She has worked in global health and development for 30 years, and after receiving a Fulbright Senior Scholar Award in Indonesia in 2011-12, she became a visiting professor at the University of Gajah School of Medicine in Yogyakarta, Indonesia. Welcome. Our final guest is Michael Rodding. He is currently founding principal of Deerhorn Advisors, a boutique consultancy focused on cross-border activities between the United States and Asia. He is the chairman of the Washington State China Relations Council, a nonprofit dedicated to promoting stronger commercial, educational, and cultural ties between Washington State and the PRC. Prior to founding Deerhorn, Mr. Rodding spent over 16 years with Microsoft, including 7 years in Asia as the president and CEO of Microsoft Greater China, Microsoft Japan, and then Microsoft Asia. Welcome, welcome all of you, and thank you for volunteering your time today. I'd like to move on to our first question. If you would please introduce your organization and its perspective in relation to the rebalance.
So I think I'm supposed to go first. So Chancellor Friedman, Professor McMillan, thank you very much for this honor to participate in such an illustrious panel and to engage all of you in a very important conversation. So I work for the State Department of Commerce, and our mission is to grow and improve jobs in the state of Washington. And that leads us very quickly to Asia, because Washington is the most trade-dependent state. We have the highest share of our employment related to exports. Well over a third of the jobs in this state can be directly tied to our sales of goods and services abroad. And it turns out that Asia has been the most rapidly growing part of the global economy for the last 10, 12 years. So Asia comprised about 15% of global GDP, and that is, it's scheduled to double here to 30% within the next 5 years. So we've seen rapid growth rates in per capita gross domestic product in those countries. So if the U.S. is projected to grow at say 2-3%, China, India, Asia overall is forecasted to grow somewhere in the neighborhood of 6-10%. So our companies that are looking to grow their markets have to be looking abroad, and they have to be looking particularly at Asia. Our role in that as a state is to help particularly our small and medium-sized businesses figure out how to sell abroad and open doors for them. It is the case, particularly in Asia, that there needs to be a government-to-government contact before there can be a business-to-business contact. And so that is a role that we in state government can and do play. Governor Gregoire led 2 trade missions to China, and I fully expect that Governor Inslee will also lead a mission to China. And those are important. They're not junkets, so the next time you guys see that in a newspaper, that's not true. They actually do end up driving real business for our small and medium-sized businesses. And so I'm looking forward to the discussion with the panel about what this whole rebalance means. I will share with you one fun fact that I gleaned from The Economist a couple years ago. When we think about rebalancing, if you look over the last 2,000 years, the last 20 centuries, in 18 of those 20 centuries, Asia had more than half of global output. So this rebalance is backed to the long-term mean in terms of where our kind of what the global distribution of economic activity is. And so I think it's certainly appropriate that our attention is turning to Asia.
Thanks, Daniel. I appreciate that. First of all, I would like to say it's an honor for me to get to be here tonight, and I really look forward to learning from all of you and from my fellow panel members. When I was thinking about this first question, introducing what my particular role is and what the rebalance means to me, I think that if you look at my recent history, it actually makes a pretty good case for the rebalance at an individual level. Most, as you heard the introduction, most of my last 12 years has been most of my energy has been spent in the Middle East. But if you go back prior to that, in the 1980s and 90s, I have a lot of time and energy and effort spent in Japan, Korea, Australia, Vietnam, Cambodia, Laos, and Thailand. And over the last year, since I returned from my last tour in Iraq, I've been focused squarely in the Asia-Pacific region, the First Corps Deputy Commander. So the Asia-Pacific region is critical to the U.S. national security interests. And I'll just establish a couple of things for you for context. You know, the world's three largest economies are all in the Asia-Pacific region. 7 of the 10 largest armies in the world are based in the Asia-Pacific region. And the United States has only 7 mutual defense treaties around the world. 5 of those with Australia, Thailand, Philippines, Republic of Korea, and Japan are all based in the Asia-Pacific region. So it's very important for us. But despite that importance, we, from a military perspective, have been out of balance with where our interests lie. And again, you know, I'll just neck down into Joint Base Lewis-McChord. Much of our attention over the last 10 or 12 years has been focused on preparing for deploying and redeploying our troops to Iraq and to Afghanistan. Right now, we still have about 6,000 troops from JBLM deployed to Afghanistan. As they return, most of them will be focused entirely on the Asia-Pacific region. We will still deploy troops for the rest of this year and into 2014 to Afghanistan, but far fewer numbers than we have in the past. And so as our troops come back, particularly at this base, we're looking to the west or to the Far East. It's very important that we look at it from a Army contribution as part of the national strategy on what can we do to help the U.S. national efforts in the Pacific. And from an Army perspective, we have 3 major terms that we use that kind of cover our strategy. Those are prevent, shape, and win. On the prevent side, what we want to do is prevent conflict. And we can prevent conflict by providing a credible deterrent to any of those who may create conflict. So we have to have a capability, and we have to have a will to employ that capability. The second is arguably even more important, which is about shaping. And from a military perspective, this is about establishing relationships, being engaged throughout the region, learning to work together with other militaries and with other agencies of the U.S. government and businesses from the U.S. and abroad so that we can build some long-term relationships. And should something go awry, whether it's a conflict or even a disaster situation that we need to respond with humanitarian assistance, we can build on relationships that are existing and work together that much more effectively and efficiently. And lastly, should all of it go awry, go back to what I said about our treaty obligations. The fundamental reason we have a military is to fight and win our nation's wars. And so we have to be prepared to do that if, in fact, it should come to conflict. So Joint Base Lewis-McChord plays a key role in all of those, different strategies in the prevent, the shape, and the win. We do have 46,000 conventional and special operations troops based here. It runs the entire gamut of military specialties, so we offer a lot to our combatant commander, who's our boss, Admiral Locklear, based in Camp Smith, Hawaii. And we do have all those capabilities, but what also makes us powerful is the fact that we offer the combatant commander and the president something here that no other base in the United States does, which is the ability to project power on an unprecedented level. Not only most of the forces I talked about were Army forces, we also have a very large McChord Air Force base with 51 C-17s based there, so they can move the Army troops anywhere in a hurry. We also have access to 4 deep water ports that we don't even have to get on a train to drive to. So we can get on the road, drive our strikers right to a port, get on ships, and move out. Unlike all the other bases, they generally have to get on trains and move to a port. It takes them that much longer to be able to respond. So rebalance is critical for the military. It's critical for our national interests. And Joint Base Lewis-McChord plays an important role in it.
I'm delighted to be here and to speak with all of you and have a dialogue with the other panelists about the rebalance. My positions at the University of Washington and my NGO position and my hats actually inform me that The rebalance is not going to impact very much, I don't think. Our longstanding academic relationships with colleagues in Asia, and the University of Washington has a very long history of doing research and building capacity in various disciplines throughout Asia. Those longstanding relationships, I don't think will be impacted in any negative way, certainly by the rebalance. Perhaps we can talk in a few minutes about how it may positively help those relationships, especially if there was an expansion of the rewording of the rebalance statements that I've seen into academia. However, thus far, there isn't really any focus on academic endeavors in the rebalancing proposals that I've seen. In terms of the NGO work that I do, that Uplift International does, it's an organization that really came about through humanitarian aid and was founded on work of actually airlifting humanitarian supplies on the 20th anniversary of the end of the Vietnam War, as the Vietnamese say, the American War, in Saigon. And from that, we've developed capacity-building programs in other countries in Southeast Asia and have a long experience in Indonesia since 1998. And the rebalance, in fact, for Indonesia may mean a lot, and we can talk more about that. Indonesia is a very strategic country for the world, and particularly in Asia, and very important to the United States. And of course, you may know about the comprehensive partnership between the United States and Indonesia that was developed and signed by President Barack Obama and SBY, the president of Indonesia. And so we'll get a bit more into that later. But in terms of any negative or positive impacts for NGO work, again, I don't see the rebalance having any impact negatively or positively on the NGO work that is done, perhaps in the area of humanitarian aid. It may impact humanitarian aid efforts, which of course are emergency disaster relief efforts, in a positive way. So.
Great. Well, also very delighted to be here. I know I'm running cleanup in this organization, so I'll try and be relatively brief. I'm here representing the business community, both in my capacity as the chair of the Washington State China Relations Council, and also running a small consulting firm which helps U.S. companies do business in Asia, and increasingly helping Asian companies come and do business here. For us, it's been clear for some time that our region's ties to Asia generally and China specifically are vitally important. We're seeing a tremendous uptick by other states in the country in terms of proactively positioning themselves vis-a-vis Asia and China. And in fact, we think we need to do an even better job relative to that work. So to the degree that there was a movement away from Asia, whether it was militarily or in terms of the time and energy that the federal government has spent on political and diplomatic matters, then this notion of a rebalancing is indeed very welcome. I think the problem comes, particularly when you look at the relationships with China, is that the rebalancing has been perceived very much as a military effort to contain China's rise in Asia. And so in that regard, hasn't necessarily helped the business climate, and hasn't necessarily helped the strengthening of long-term trust between China and the United States. I certainly realize the premise for the rebalancing, and I also realize that it is broader than a military-only and China-only initiative, but I think it's important to point out that that's the way it's being received by, in effect, the most important partner country in Asia-Pacific. And so from that perspective, I think it's actually best that we almost say that we've rebalanced and that we start from the fact that the United States believes Asia is vitally important across all spheres and that vis-a-vis China, we need to actually figure out a way to take our relationship to the next level, despite its ongoing complications and potential levels of competition. In fact, former Prime Minister Kevin Rudd from Australia, who also served as foreign minister, who's a fluent Mandarin speaker and is a really well-known person in this regard, wrote just last month in Foreign Affairs that it's time to move beyond the pivot in terms of U.S.-China relationships. And I'll just close by saying that the announcement that President Obama will meet with President Xi Jinping in California, appropriately on the West Coast, in June for a two-day summit that is going to lack a lot of the pomp and circumstance of previous meetings and really get down to how we can work together going forward is a great and welcome development.
Thank you. And your comments, thank you everyone for your introduction. Your comments actually ties just beautifully into the question, moving beyond the pivot to the rebalance and addressing the challenges and opportunities. So the first question we have for you today.
The big opportunity for us is that this is a region that's continuing to grow economically and that we have an opportunity to sell more of our goods and services into that economy, and that will be good for us. So I think that is the most obvious opportunity. You know, the challenges or the threats, I think, are several-fold. You know, we have a big interest in the sustained peace and prosperity of the Asian Pacific. So if you look at kind of what are our top two trading partners in terms of the increase in exports over the last 5 years, well, it's Japan and China. So we want those folks to get along. And so to the extent that they start, you know, arguing over certain atolls and certain seas, that's bad. That could be bad for business. So for all, and bad for a bunch of other reasons too. So we definitely have a stake in the ongoing security and stability of that region. I think the two other things that just come up that I've observed in my work, one is I think there, because we've come through this very tough recession and there is some voices more of a sense of isolationism, in certain contexts, I've seen it surprisingly sometimes on some of our college campuses where as we have conversations about how we're going to meet the talent needs of our high technology workforce, a real aversion to thinking about having, you know, different foreign nationals come in and stay in this country. I think that has been good for our country, and I think immigration has helped us, but I see some resistance there. The other issue I'll just put on the table and perhaps for further discussion is there's some of the environmental threats that China is confronting as it's gone through its just breakneck industrialization. It comes back to us on things like coal exports and how are we going to deal with, you know, global warming and a whole host of environmental issues that get wrapped up into our dealings with China. So I think big economic opportunity and a big stake in maintaining stability there and some you know, threats on how do we maintain our goodwill and an environment that allows us to continue to grow and prosper.
Vivia, thanks. I know that the point of your question was implications for Washington State, and I'll just ask you to bear with me. We'll get there eventually. But I'd like to talk about challenges and opportunity on a large scale first, and certainly there's implications for Washington State, but then I want to neck it down just to a little bit more on what it means at a local level. So for challenges, I think the one challenge that we all face is budget uncertainty. I agree with what Michael said, regardless of what we said, it may be perceived that the rebalance is all about the military. It's not. It's a whole of government approach, and in fact, I would offer potentially a whole of nation approach that's much larger than the government. But uncertainty about budgets affects all of that. It's just if we don't know what we can count on, it's going to limit what we can invest, not just monetarily, but in time and energy in some of these relationships I was talking about. I think from a security perspective, North Korea, Democratic Republic of Korea, provides us a fair amount of uncertainty and concern as well. And we only have to take the events and the rhetoric coming out of North Korea from this last spring to be able to understand that this rhetoric has continued from generation to generation, and the threats are out there. They are in fact real, and so there is a concern there and a challenge there with what will North Korea do, and maybe as importantly, what can the rest of us in the region do to help North Korea do what's positive for its own people as well as the rest of the region. I'd like to talk a little bit about what Michael said about perceptions, and perceptions in China in particular. Regardless of what we have said, it does seem like there's a fairly consistent perception in China that the rebalance is about the military, and the focus is on containment. From our perspective, that's not the case at all. Our focus is actually on cooperation. If you look at who has been providing the security access to the global commons throughout the Asia Pacific over the last measurable period of years, it's been largely the United States. We have provided that level of security for all nations so that they can all thrive and reach their potential, particularly in the economic side. And what we would like is a sense of cooperation. We see that China's a rising power. We recognize it, we embrace it, and we want to be partners with China and welcome them into be partners with us in the security atmosphere so that we can provide access to global commons for all. So I think that is both a challenge, but it's also an opportunity. Now, a little bit more to the opportunities in particular. I think Michael also mentioned ASEAN. Again, very important, great history. It's very important that the United States is now committed as a member of ASEAN. And so there's opportunity for economic cooperation. But what we have not yet realized is how do we take a spirit of cooperation on the economic side and leverage that to develop more of a regional security architecture? So one is that it's security focused. We have not yet been able to do that. Unlike what we see with the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, which is a multinational organization focused on security, what we have in the Asia Pacific region are dominantly binational relationships. And what we want to do is actually help turn them into a multinational relationship. I think we have tremendous opportunities there. More specifically, what does this mean to Washington State? I mentioned a little bit about the engagements. But our soldiers are committed to relationships throughout the region. In the last year, we had soldiers from the United States Army participate in exercises or engagements in 23 countries in the Asia Pacific region. That all makes them better soldiers, and in fact, they then bring something back locally with a wider perspective of the world that can only help the local situation and their relationships here in the community. But more importantly, what we're starting to do is work to bring, instead of it just be a series of exercises where our troops deploy to the Philippines or Thailand or Australia, we're actually starting to work some programs where we invite the militaries of our partners to the United States for exercises. We have one, and we're actually looking to build many more. So the one exercise I'll mention is Exercise Rising Thunder. It's an exercise we do every year here in the state of Washington. We bring a large contingent of forces from the Japanese Ground Self-Defense Force. They train at Joint Base Lewis-McChord and at Yakima Training Center, and they'll do so again this year in both August and September. They get the benefit of a good exchange with us. We learn from each other militarily, but I would argue what's maybe even a more powerful long-term effect is bringing those soldiers to experience what our culture is like in this part of the country. In fact, last year about half of them signed up and participated in a half marathon hosted in Gig Harbor, just as an example. Mm-hmm. And one of their soldiers won it, if I'm not mistaken. So, but it's a great opportunity for exchange and building relationships.
Um, In follow-up to Major General Buchanan's comments about security, as a health professional, I think about avian influenza and the infectious disease threats that are threats for all of us, because infectious disease agents know no boundaries. They don't understand sovereign nation borders, and they do cross and fly around the world with our mobile societies, going in so many airplanes every minute of every day. And as we've seen through the responses to the recent and not so recent infectious disease epidemics, some of which have become pandemics, we realize that it's very important to share information and very important to collaborate. And collaboration often in the health sector is one way to get engagement. And it may be an opportunity to work in the health sector together in ASEAN and in Asia, which many of us are already doing, but that could be a venue through which we discuss security and other threats as well. And often it is not perceived as so threatening when we're talking about improving health for populations. And that leads me to an opportunity also in regards to the natural disasters and the response to those disasters or other man-made disasters for humanitarian aid. And of course, the first responders and the best responders are the military. They can get to and move earth and buildings and save lives, and others cannot do that. And so in collaboration with NGOs, and all the NGOs in Washington State, and we have a lot of them who respond to disasters, we might be able to engage countries, countries' militaries, build capacity, train, and it can be done in Washington State. And so I think we have an incredible capacity to do this in Washington State with our strong university systems, the ability to work across disciplines. And I have to say the University of Washington is a leader in this, and I'm an example. I do health and human rights and international bioethics and social justice and health. And so I have many appointments, have many different kinds of students in all of my classes. And we're doing very interesting research projects with lots of networks in Asia, as a matter of fact. And so I think this is a great opportunity to involve all kinds of disciplines and maybe focusing on issues that are all about security, but with a softer approach.
It's interesting, the economic relationship between the United States and China over the last 30 years has been one in which largely it's been American companies who have sort of led that engagement, whether it's companies that are having their products manufactured in China for reimportation back to the United States, or it's companies like Microsoft or Starbucks or Boeing who now have huge, huge presences in China, have benefited enormously from the opening up of that market. What is happening now is that China is starting to go global. They're directing their investment outwards. There is a tremendous opportunity for inbound investment into this community. From Chinese companies, from Chinese citizens, from Chinese institutions, and I think we should all view that as a good thing on a number of levels. One is it means that the economic relationship is more mutually, it flows in both directions, so it's mutually beneficial. So it means the long-term stability of the relationship is enhanced. The second thing is that as Chinese companies do business here, they have to do business based on our rules of governance, our rules of labor, our rules of the environment, and that ultimately is a good thing. The third thing is that it's an opportunity for ongoing economic stimulation. The challenge I see is that we're not ready for it. Because we as a community, and I've shared my views with Daniel and the government, are not being as proactive as we could and should be vis-a-vis other parts of the United States in terms of attracting this investment. And the other is, even though we are so blessed in being a very diverse area with a very significant Asian population and a place that people from Asia view as a very positive place to be, we don't necessarily have the community supportive of this increase in investment from outside, from Asia, and particularly from China. And I think that's a dialogue that we all need to have.
I could just pick up on that because it's a great point, and it really is both a big opportunity and a challenge. And I think, you know, so one of the consequences of the trade imbalance between the U.S. and China is that China is holding a bunch of dollars. They've got to get back here somehow. And so one good way is for China to come and invest in this country. And so that is something that we are involved with in terms of this, you know, trying to look at opportunities. But I must say from, you know, we are accountable to elected officials and legislators, and it's much easier to talk to them about how great it is for Washington companies to sell their products to China than it is to have Chinese investors come in and buy Washington companies. And so that is, and even though both are, I mean, they're both necessary, and, you know, to, if you're in an industry that needs capital, that the opportunity to have large amounts of long-term patient capital come in and get behind your enterprise is a huge opportunity, but the optics are challenging. And so, I mean, there's a number of reasons why I've not been as responsive to Michael as he might have liked on this topic, some of which is our own state budget circumstance. And part of it also is this, how do we, and I think there really is an opportunity for the public sector and the private sector to come together and lead around this issue. But part of it's gonna be how it is addressing some of these, some of it's just, you know, xenophobia, and some of it's, you know, control and concern about IP and jobs. And I think, but you've got to take those issues head on, because ultimately it is a big opportunity for the state.
That's
Debbie,
right.
I'd like to jump in on something Beth said.
Absolutely.
We'll get to you in a second with questions. but you know, when she mentioned the military response to humanitarian assistance or disaster responses, this is one thing about this region that we know is going to happen. We know there are going to be typhoons. We know that there are going to be earthquakes, and they are going to cause a lot of problems for the people in those countries. And so we do have a capability to respond militarily, and we do so frequently. But it's also many times that those responses actually get the dialogue going and help us start having relationships. Even sometimes, you know, we may not be able to go. Initially, if you go back a number of years, we weren't able to go military to military on war fighting skills with the Chinese and how we were going to relate to each other militarily. But we could have joint training exercises focused on humanitarian assistance. We could do medical exchanges. And I think the Chinese announced this year that they're going to participate in RIMPAC, which is a large exercise in the Pacific Command area that involves security in many cases on the maritime side, but through many partner nations in the Asia Pacific region. And it was humanitarian assistance and disaster response that got the dialogue going. So I do think it's a huge opportunity, and we have more of them out there.
Oh yeah, they'll keep coming.
These are really dynamic points of entry. I mean, we've moved from stepping up exports and encouraging medium-sized businesses to think globally, to General Buchanan's point about challenges and opportunity almost synonymous. I mean, they go together. They're so interlinked. And then Dr. Rivin's point about it's how you frame it, and what we can enter this whole engagement through collaboration on issues that do not have borders. And then here we have a huge challenge. How do we get China to invest in us? How do we get China to see us as opportunity. And so with these really excellent points of entry, I open up the questions to the audience. If you would like to pose questions, we have microphones on either side. Are there any questions for our panelists on the opportunities and challenges for Washington State in the next 5 years?
We do have a relationship with Vietnam that, with the Socialist Republic of Vietnam, I won't go back to, you know, what happened in the 1960s and 70s. It really goes back to the early 1990s and started with a significant movement in this country to account for our soldiers and civilians that were missing in action or had been prisoners of war, still missing from the Vietnam War. And so what began as an accounting effort for all those troops actually got our militaries working together in the early 1990s. And since then, that has expanded to the point where in the late 1990s, we opened an embassy in Hanoi, consulates in Saigon. I think there might be a consulate in Da Nang. I'm a little bit dated right now on that. But we do have a fairly extensive relationship with the Vietnamese that started with the POW MIA accounting effort. Every year, we have operations ongoing in Vietnam, also in Laos and Cambodia, but dominantly in Vietnam, that are based on interviews, case investigations, recovery efforts, et cetera. And that got the dialogue going to where we now have fairly frequent medical exchanges, et cetera. We have not, that I know of, and I may be incorrect here, but we have not gone on to the more traditional warfighting relationships, military exchanges, where we're focused on warfighting skills. But we do have a good dialogue with the Vietnamese. They participate in a regular basis in U.S. Pacific Command exercises and training events. And I think it's very important, actually. Vietnam is a significant player in the region, and it's very important that we have a relationship with them.
Yes.
They do. And, of course, if you look at the capabilities that Vietnam has with its economic stability and potential infrastructure, you know, airports, deep water seaports, Cameron Bay in particular. There's a lot of economic potential, which also helps feed our military exchanges.
It is just a little bit of a build. It's amazing because I'm the first person to be guilty of too much focus on China. But when you look at Vietnam, Thailand, Philippines, and Indonesia, collectively, that's almost 400 million people. And those are all economies that, you know, are growing, not to mention Myanmar, of course, which has just come into the fold with over 60 million people. Those are all, you know, economies and countries and peoples that represent phenomenal opportunity for us, and we shouldn't neglect them.
We have a question. I'd like to, just a friendly reminder to state your name and affiliation, please. Thanks.
My name's Chris Webster. I'm a citizen of Tacoma. And I'd like to see if we could put some more meat on the bones of this notion of rebalancing. It seems to me the military has an idea of what that means to them and how they want to pursue that. But as Michael pointed out, what looks like a hand across the sea from here may look like a fist coming the other way. And certainly what the Chinese are doing in the South China Seas looks kind of like a fist to me. But apart from that, we've talked about economics, you know, selling more stuff there and maybe allowing them to buy stuff here. And I don't see that as rebalancing. We've always wanted to do that. And the same with the rest of Southeast Asia. So politically, even the ASEAN thing, from the Chinese standpoint, looks like we're trying to block them from moving into better economic relationships with their neighbors in South China or Southeast Asia. So how do we do this? What does it mean beyond this military idea? What does it mean politically, socially, economically, that's new and different?
Well, from my perspective, there's clearly been a distraction from a political and military perspective in the Middle East, and the general can speak to that much better than I can. But it is very important for us collectively to recognize that within the next 10 years, certainly maybe in the next 5 years, China will be the largest economy in the world. And that if you look at collectively Asia's contribution to GDP and also to lots of other problems like the environment, there's almost no more important set of issues for us as a country and for us as a community here in Washington State when we think internationally to deal with. So part of it is just being very explicit in expressing that and recognizing that it will not be necessarily always positive and there will be issues and challenges, but it's incumbent upon us as a community to figure out what ways in which we can make those relationships mutually beneficial, positive, and ultimately contribute to the broader stability of the world.
And I do think it's not, you know, there's a bunch of things that have been going on for some time, and so you know, there's Mandarin being taught in Seattle schools. You've got, you know, the UW in Seattle has a growing number of Chinese exchange students who are coming there. So there are a number of things that have been happening at a cultural, educational, and business level that I think reinforce, you know, that are part of the rebalance. It's not like we woke up one day. I mean, this has been going on for some time, but I think, as Michael says, part of it is identifying it, naming it, and figuring out what are the, how do we keep doing more, and also being aware of the double-edged side of some of these things.
Please go ahead.
Yeah, just wanted to comment on the relationship between the United States and Indonesia, which is growing. And it is not a relationship between the United States and China, but the United States and Indonesia. And I think that the rebalance and the discussion around the rebalance is very important, but things have been happening before the rebalance. Many relationships between the United States and Asia have, I mean, there was a turning before the rebalance statement and all the media around it. And especially in Southeast Asia, I think.
You could say they just finally caught up with what was really going on already. I mean, they were sort of like, oh, yeah, we better, our nonprofits are already engaged there.
And in particular, as I've said, Indonesia is a very strategic country. Much of the world's oil comes through the Malacca Straits. It is it's a new democracy in 1998. It became a democracy and is learning slowly how to do this at all levels of government. It's really nice to see how local government is open to participatory governance, and civil society, the non-governmental sector, is becoming bolder. And I've been involved in working in capacity building to improve the ability of people to speak out for what they want.
World's most populous Muslim nation as well. So that's
it is right.
Significant
it is absolutely. It's the fourth largest country in the world, the largest population, which is 90% Muslim, and it is the third largest democracy in the world. And it is doing better than our economy in the United States. So the growth is 6 to 7.
And sixth out of, it's the top six out of countries we export to in terms of growth over the last 5 years.
Right. It's moved from the low low income country to a middle income country. It's a low middle income country, but it's moved quite a bit. It's doing very well. The archipelago nation of 16,000 islands. And so we do have a comprehensive partnership with this country, a very unusual partnership that the United States at the presidential level has with this country. And there are many pillars. Actually, the State Department talks about 8 pillars. One of the pillars, which has gotten a lot of support by the White House, this was a White House initiative initially, is the education pillar. And in fact, the University of Washington has been very involved in getting grants and working on exchanges with faculty in higher education institutions in Indonesia. We received deans from universities in Indonesia, and we've been educating and exchanging throughout Washington State. So there are other pillars as well, security and economic development. But just wanted to say for Washington State, it's a very important part of what we're doing in academia.
Thank you. We have 2 questions there and 1 here, and then we'll move on to our next question for the panelists. Please go ahead.
Okay. My name is Will McGuire. I'm actually an assistant professor here at UW-Tacoma, and I'm going to commit the sin of focusing too much on China. I apologize. my question actually has to do with what seems to be a tendency on both sides of the Pacific here, I guess, to view in some sense, economic competition is sometimes a zero-sum game and potentially a path towards strategic conflict. And I'm thinking about, specifically in China, the recent cyber attacks, the report that came out that showed that the Chinese government and military were perpetrating cyber attacks in the United States for the purpose primarily of finding industrial technology, which has obvious economic implications, and also kind of embedded in some of the language that we've been hearing here about the optics of foreign direct investment by Chinese multinationals in the United States. So I guess, is there a way in the course of this rebalancing that we can separate those two things, that there's, in part of this, a way of separating out potential strategic conflict from a healthy economic competition? I don't know.
I'll jump into the philosophy side here. I think that when you get to know people, it starts with relationships, and the more you get to know people, and I would say understanding of each other is the first step that we can take, and we can take to break down some of those walls that may exist. And sometimes they're based on misperceptions or lack of trust or historical grievances. There's all kinds of reasons why people may not trust each other. We have to figure out how we can work together to break down those barriers. And I think the engagement and development of those relationships is critical. And it's clearly not just a military thing. It goes across all of the organizations we represent.
Well, I think it's important to step back and recognize that despite significant problems and heated rhetoric from both directions, if you look at the track record of the U.S.-China relationship across the board since renormalization, it's been phenomenally successful. In fact, every administration, arguably, almost all of them came in with negative rhetoric, and almost all of them moved the ball forward when you look at it in the collective sense of that relationship. Having said that, because China's rise in the last 10 years, particularly since 2002 to 2003, has been so immense and impactful on a global scale, I think we're all trying to figure out how to grapple with that. And I think that there are still a lot of open questions as to how to come up with that next strategic framework for a relationship, which recognizes that there will be issues of contention that need to be dealt with on an ongoing basis, but also recognizes that collectively we're much better off working together than we are in stressing the negatives. But I actually think we've done a good job of that. It's just very often not evident by some of the political and other rhetoric. I do want to touch on cybersecurity because it is the newest, if you will, among these complications and very important one. And coming from the technology industry, it's one that I focus on a lot in my work. You know, the notion of state-sponsored, state-directed corporate espionage is, I think, by every account, beyond the red line and something that should not be tolerated. And I think the degree to which the reports that have come out have specified the very detailed, in a very detailed way, what has been happening has been, unfortunately, the culmination of a long-standing dialogue and no action on the part of the Chinese to do anything about it. I think right now the next step really forward on this is to come up with some multilateral mechanism for dialogue on cybersecurity, because there really is no regime to talk about the issues related to cybersecurity on a multilateral basis. And also that if you look at historically, the Chinese deal much better in curbing their behavior when they're part of a multilateral regime than when they're being told by one country that what they're doing is wrong. And so I hope that that's the next step.
Much of my work has been in public affairs, trying to shape the way that the United States is perceived in various nations abroad. And to that end, I want to go back to a discussion that was kind of started earlier in this conversation about the image of Asian nations in Washington State, specifically as that might impact the investment opportunities here for Asia-based companies. So specifically, if you could talk about how much of that problem is really a public affairs issue for governments like the government of China versus real obstacles to foreign direct investment in Washington State. Thanks.
I think it's a communications challenge. I mean, I really do. I think, you know, that part of it, that there is rhetoric and fear that goes to it. But I think when you look at specific deals, that you can get people comfortable with them. But I think when you talk about it in the general, that, you know, China's going to come in and buy corporations, and that sounds scary. But when you say, you know, here's a particular investment, you know, we have a major Chinese partner, and they're bringing in this kind of, you know, capital into this community, that then people can get excited about that. So I think, but it's delicate. And I think, you know, Michael's been involved in some projects. We're aware of some projects. You know, there's one down in the San Francisco Bay Area, you know, large real estate development potentially near downtown San Francisco that I think is a little bit fraught. I mean, has been a little bit fraught with, you know, as when they've tried to kind of have Chinese capital and Chinese construction company partnered with a U.S. construction company that could be a win-win, but it's gotten a little sticky. So my belief is that we can get past some of the fears, but some of it depends on how, you know, the deal and what's actually behind it, and then some of it's the communication. So Michael, do you have a...
Relative to other parts of the country, we're phenomenally lucky because we have already a very diverse population from Asia that is multi-generational in nature, that's been very successful. We have a large influx of new people from Asia that are doing extremely well and I think are happy and comfortable here, and we collectively are happy about that. And that's not the case in other parts of the country. So I think we're starting from a good base. I do think there is a broad communications issue that actually goes beyond Washington State. You know, there is a perception partly fueled by the Chinese government that the U.S. government is very arbitrary in whenever it looks at and reviews potential commercial deals about the potential national security issues related to those deals, particularly through a process known as CFIUS. And actually, if you dig down, it's not very arbitrary. It's actually very well run, and a large, vast preponderance of those transactions are never even reviewed, and a vast preponderance of those that are reviewed actually go in smoothly. But we're just doing a horrible job of communicating that, and we're letting you know, that story be told in a way that is not beneficial to the fact that we relatively have an extremely open and transparent economy that welcomes foreign investment, we in the United States, and then we here in Washington State as well. So we have some work to do on public affairs and communications, both at the state level and also at the national level.
I'd just like to, one brief comment. First of all, thanks for your service. Thanks for all you've done in the public diplomacy side. The challenge I think we're talking about here is not so much about communicating with the residents of another country. It's really about our own. And, I guess my largest concern about the rebalance and what could, in fact, sabotage it, if you will, is an idea here about isolationism. You know, especially when we come out of two wars, we have all the economic challenges we've had over the last 5 years, there might be a tendency for us to look inward and be fearful of those on the outside. And to me, that could, in fact, derail this rebalance. And if we look inward, I think we do so at our own peril.
Just to really underline that, we did some analysis where we kind of took all the companies in the state and broke them into two groups, those who export and sell abroad and those who don't. And that first group never lost jobs during the recession. They continued to grow even just a little bit, but in 2010, and they've absolutely led employment growth coming out of the session. And I mean, this is we're a state that lost 200,000 jobs, close to 200,000 jobs during the recession. We haven't regained all of them back yet, but our industries that are involved in selling goods and services abroad really have maintained and grown their employment. And so I think that's part of the story which helps us get out of an isolationist perspective is we really do see our welfare tied to being engaged and open to the world.
Thank you. The topics that have been raised here are just, they fold into the other questions that are coming ahead. So, I mean, we're just at our first question. This is pretty incredible. Thank you for waiting so patiently. Please go ahead.
I'm Paul Frankenberg. I'm on the board of directors of the Tacoma Musical Playhouse. We produce theater. And in addition to the six shows that we provide every season, we also go out to other cities where there's theater that we can show our patrons. Not that we're going to put it on, but see it. So we go to New York, London, Chicago, other places like that. For the last 10 years, I've had a business in Shanghai. And I've retired. But when I heard that they're going to be making tours continuously, I said, well, where are you going to go next and next? Well, they weren't sure. I said, have you thought about going to China? Wow, what an idea. Well, I had the background for it, and I said, give me a little time, and I'll put a tour together for you. I have done that for the last 6 months, and we're taking 30 people who have paid a lot to go to China with us and see four cities, and we're going to show them some theater there. But the main idea is to show them China. Here we have 30 people that I would like to use as ambassadors who wouldn't understand half of what you people have said tonight. So the question to you is, how do I bring them up to half of what I've heard here so that they can go back and be intelligent ambassadors?
You know, I just have to say, they don't need to know half of what we've talked about here. I mean, I think, my experience, I've been fortunate to have lived abroad early at various stages of my career. And I think, it is the human connection. And it's, when you get to know people, and people realize that, hey, we have all this in common, and it's kind of that personal connection which really forms the balance. Then you talk about food, and you talk about music, and you talk about art, and, those, you build those human foundations of relationship. And then, the rest of the stuff, that really is the foundation on which you talk about economics and, diplomacy and how do we relate as nations. But it does start up with that foundation of human connection.
Reinforces that importance of soft power. Please, were you going to say something?
No, I was just going to say that the human-to-human connections between the United States and China are amazingly strong and rich and diverse, and we're very lucky for that. And generally speaking, the perception of Chinese people towards Americans is very, very positive, has been for some time, remains to be the case. And if there was one message that I would say is that, because you're there to listen and learn to their theater. I think it's really great that you communicate that you want to learn and that we're not necessarily the communicators we're being communicated to. I think that's a little bit of a problem that we have generally. And so, you know, the fact that you're there with ears open is going to be fantastic.
Yeah, we talk in the academy all the time about bi-directional learning. So the people who are visiting China need to listen, learn, and then the Chinese will also be learning from the group that is visiting as well. And so that's really where that communication and exchange starts. And but the listening piece is hard for a lot of people.
Yeah.
I'd like to move us to a very specific question. If you could comment on the kinds of partnerships and exchanges you're involved in, and what is their value or importance? So we're getting to specifics here.
Yeah, I'll mention two. The trade missions are an important role. I mentioned those earlier on, but I think that is something that we do at the state is, you know, we consciously plan a trip, we recruit business leaders and set up a series of meetings. And so I think that's a very highly productive activity and something we'll continue to support. I think there are a lot of important partnerships that our research institutions have made in China and other parts of Asia, where I know the Pacific Northwest National Labs in the Tri-Cities is working very closely on issues around carbon sequestration. Are there any number of partnerships that UW, University of Washington has across any number of disciplines? So I think those really are very important in terms of building this relationship, advancing the frontiers of human knowledge, and you know, helping us solve some of our big problems. And then the final one just is the foreign exchange students. And you know, we don't think of them as education as an export of this state, but in fact it is. We are selling our education services to people from abroad, and they're coming here. And I think that is a very important source of you know, export revenue and also building of this connection with people. And I think that is is key. I do think I have a son who's a sophomore up at the Washington campus of University of Washington, and I think there are some, we need to do better on that campus in terms of integrating. There has been a large influx of Chinese students, and I think they don't always get well integrated into the broader campus life. And I think, you know, UW's going to respond to that. But I think it is, those are several areas where I think, you know, partnerships are really happening and deepening.
On the military side, partnerships and exchanges have been focused dominantly, I would say, on our five treaty nations. Australia, Philippines, Thailand, Japan, and Republic of Korea. But we do have them with other nations as well. I'll give you a quick example. Our Corps is having its major exercise this summer, a joint task force certification exercise in Australia. We've been preparing for that for some time. Just last week, we had a number of Australian officers up here. The 1st Australian Division is going to be subordinate to 1st Corps in this exercise, and then in the latter half of July, our headquarters will deploy to Australia and we'll work together. So that's an example of the kind of exchanges that we have. But I mentioned some other countries' militaries interested in coming to this region, and I already talked about the Japanese, but another one is Singapore. We have a relationship with the military from Singapore. They're very interested in coming here to train. If you look at what we have at Yakima Training Center, access to more than 400,000 acres, we can do every sort of military training imaginable. You know, they're very excited to come to learn from us, but also it's exciting for us because we have an opportunity to learn from them. Now, I'll take this a little bit different flavor, and that was about exchanges and partnerships abroad. But again, from the military perspective, what's very important for us and helping us to learn and do our jobs better and more effectively is our partnerships that are here locally. And I'll cover two briefly. One is with universities and another is with businesses. So on the university side, we have a robust relationship with University of Tacoma, or University of Washington Tacoma, with Pacific Lutheran, with University of Washington in Seattle, with the Bothell campus, I've taught classes in leadership there, also taught classes in leadership at Oregon State at their MBA program. And just to give you an example of how important that was for me in my own development, about 50% of the population in this graduate level class that I was teaching on leadership were students from other countries. And a significant number of them were from China. Had one student from Iran. And so it's a great chance to have a dialogue and actually learn from each other. And this gets back to the issue about breaking down some barriers. With businesses, we have growing relationships with many large corporations and small ones, small businesses, but Boeing, Amazon, Starbucks. But Jimmy Collins, if you could raise your hand, Jimmy sponsors an organization called Hire America's Heroes. Very important for us to have relationship with many of these businesses because of the amount of troops that we have actually transitioning from the military every year. So we have about, just from Joint Base Lewis-McChord, about 6,000 a year transitioning out of the military. And of course, they're great potential employees, but Jimmy helps link up prospective employees with businesses. And these are many people that have world views. So, you know, they actually offer a lot to the companies that they join. So that's a little bit on our partnerships and exchanges.
With my two hats, the University of Washington, as we've been hearing about, has a lot of exchanges. We have exchanges at the undergraduate level, at the graduate level. We have exchanges among universities in Asia and here at home with faculty. We have visiting scholars going back and forth. We have research networks. So we partner with universities, other universities, and other faculties to do collaborative research, to do collaborative conferences. We have many schools have a number of collaborations with faculties throughout Asia, teaching, capacity building in their universities. For instance, I help Indonesian medical schools build their bioethics departments. They need a lot of help in the area of research ethics, as many institutions in Asia do right now, and standards for research ethics, informed consent issues, clinical ethics, how doctors, how nurses and others relate to their clients or patients. It's a very big issue. And we have a lot of exchanges that are supported by the U.S. government as well. So the Fulbright office in the State Department is supporting a lot of this capacity building and exchanges for our universities.
Just very briefly, there are a tremendous amount of exchanges on the business front, but we're connected by virtue of the China Relations Council with two important initiatives. One is the Confucius Institute here in the state of Washington, which is actually the Chinese government facilitating and supporting the teaching and learning of the Chinese language and Chinese culture. And we have two focal points, one at the University of Washington, one in the Seattle School District for the Confucius Institute, and it's going phenomenally well. I just went to their annual banquet, it was a lot of fun, but it was great to see the performances by the youngsters in middle school and high school who are all learning Chinese, including one young man who's a seventh grader who composed a poem, a traditional poem, and performed it in Chinese. And just astounded the audience. So that was really great to see. And then more recently, the Washington Women's Foundation just hosted a group of 15 women from China involved in philanthropy, focused on the emerging NGO sector and also the emerging philanthropic movement in China. And it was, I think, a very rich and and mutually beneficial exchange and just a great opportunity for all of us.
These great examples of deep engagement, and I'd like to open up the question to the audience. Is there other questions regarding these partnerships or exchanges and their impact? Let's see if we can make time for about three questions and then move on to the next question for our panelists. Thank you. Please go ahead.
Thanks. Tom Ulizen, Washington Army Guard. I've got, the Guard's kind of a strange beast, so I need to talk about both roles real quick. Full-time, I'm the G6, which is like the alpha geek for the state. And then part-time, I have an IO battalion. So with that, about half of the 23 nations General spoke about, we actually send folks to on overseas deployment training. But the most important thing about that is I'm a big fan of the state partnership program. Now, you may or may not know, Washington scored huge on state partners because we got Thailand. So that's the country's oldest treaty partner. Great. Are we looking at adding to that? Are we going to add an additional country? Because I think that's an opportunity. If we do, I'd like for it to be in the Pacific Rim. So if anybody wants to jump on that and dive all over it.
I will tell you that our state partnership programs, for those of you that don't know, the Army Guard in particular, but it may include the Air Guard as well, maintains partnerships with countries around the world. And some of them are fairly easy to understand. So Illinois has a partnership with Poland, for example. Large Polish population based in Chicago, so that works. Georgia with Georgia is another example. Not because there's a large Georgian population in Georgia, but it was easy probably for everybody to get their minds around. But when I talked about the military aspects of rebalance, of course, the Guard has been very involved and deployed regularly to Afghanistan and Iraq. But all during those deployments, they still maintain these state partnership programs. And we have partnership programs in Oregon and Idaho that are also focused in the region, Bangladesh, Vietnam, all very important. And in fact, when we on the active component side want to deal with Thailand, we'll be going next year from a First Corps perspective to Thailand for Exercise Cobra Gold. The Washington Guard will play a role, and in fact, they have much more history in their relationship with Thailand than we do. So we look to expand on that. It's very helpful for us that the Guard forces that are based in this region are actually focused in the Asia-Pacific region, so we get more synergy through those relationships.
Please go ahead with your question.
Hi, my name is Jeanette Allen. I'm with the Henry M. Jackson Foundation. And part of, we give, our huge partnership is with the University of Washington, Seattle, as well as Tacoma, but also with the National Bureau of Asian Research. And in June, we will be traveling to DC to meet with senior staff of Congress to bring them up to date and brief them about ASEAN and Myanmar and what's going on in Asia and the reset, or I should say the reset. So what would you like to communicate, if you could, and if I could relay the message to senior staffers on, you know, when they go and to these, be careful with
the solve the budget.
Right. Besides that point. What would you like? What would you like them to walk away with, so that when they go and represent us at these huge negotiation briefings abroad, in a good light?
Looking at me, so I'll take a stab on it. It goes back to my comments about the importance of relationship and maintaining engagement. So. I just think we need to have a spirit of willing to maintain relationships and to build relationships maybe when we haven't even had them in the past. And you mentioned Myanmar or Burma. I mean, a great example. If you look at the history of that country, you know, over the last 30 years and now look at the opportunities we have with an opening. What we want is to put water and fertilizer on that relationship. You know, last year, the U.S. Army Pacific Commander, Lieutenant General Frank Wersinski, was the first military leader to visit
to visit the country in years and years and years. And so we have an opening. It's not very mature. It needs work. But that's an example. You know, we have civilian control of the military for a reason. It's exactly what our country's been built on, and it's absolutely critical. But we also, we need to encourage more our civilian leadership of the military in getting those kinds of relationships going. So it starts with diplomacy. You know, occasionally we have an opportunity that starts with a disaster response, because frequently the military is very helpful and frequently the first ones on the scene. So we can start a relationship there, but if it isn't backed by a strong diplomatic effort, it's probably not going to go very far. And so that we just need continued help and investment from our civilian leadership to maintain those relationships and build them.
Could I also add that if I could recommend that there should be a language that clearly articulates the rebalance should be a rebalance beyond a focus on the military. And this is in support of Jeff's comments, really. But it really does need to be multi-sectoral and more comprehensive. And not just in sentiment, but language, you know, clearly articulating that. Yeah. Because the statements so far really focus mostly on the military.
Yeah. Please go ahead.
Hi, I'm Brian Nelson. I'm also a Guard soldier. I'm the J2, or the intelligence officer, for our Special Operations Detachment Pacific. And I'm a linguist, went to the Monterey School 100 years ago. And what occurred to me when we were talking, it was a question previously about, gentlemen, sir, with your dance, it's difficult to learn when you don't understand what anyone's saying. And I think that frequently it might be it's the other side of our gregarious American nature that we want to say something, but we don't know how to listen because we don't understand the language. So my point specifically would be, what would your recommendations be about getting serious about speaking a foreign language? Whether it's investment, I understand that the Confucius, that's great. But when we start teaching language in high school, you've missed it, right? We've pruned our neurons, and we're always going to speak with an accent. Or is there value in focusing on intensive language training for adults to at least just build rapport, which you might be able to see, but I guess by the way I'm asking it, you probably understand where I feel. But
no more language training, right? Stop that. That's
right,
bad.
Stop it. Stop it, right? There's trilingual, bilingual, and American, right? But I would be interested to hear your thoughts on getting serious about language.
Right. I think that we as a nation have not been serious about it. And all you have to do is spend some time in another country and you see how woefully unprepared our children are for engagement throughout the world, because they tend to speak only one language. I go back to, I spent 1 year in Geneva, Switzerland on an international security fellowship. Yeah, that was a tough tour. I had the great fortune of having my wife and my three kids with me at the time. And my kids went to an international school. They all had to take, we were living in the French-speaking part of Switzerland, so they all had to learn French. And the two younger ones had to take a different language as well. And even though the basic course of instruction was in English, my two younger kids picked Spanish, and it turns out that their Spanish teacher did not speak English, so she would explain things in French. And you know, now my two sons are fluent French speakers, and my daughter's a fluent Spanish speaker. And I think that's very, very important. But we don't have that kind of emphasis here. And I don't know the right way to get that. I tend to think it's probably not legislation or something from the top down, but from the bottom up, just a understanding the value and the criticality of being able to communicate around the world, I think is real important. I will tell you, I make it a point to try to work hard to learn some basic greetings, certainly the customs and those kinds of things, but basic greetings in the language wherever I happen to be deployed at the time. And because I've been to Iraq a lot, I can get by fairly well in Arabic. It doesn't do me a lot of great good in this theater, but the important thing is when you start, I think if you try to communicate in somebody else's language, it just breaks down all kinds of barriers. You may struggle, but it's that desire to work at it. And I think you get some great insights about culture as well. So I think it's very, very important.
A couple quick anecdotes I have. So my nephew was interested in China, and so they had Chinese exchange students, and so he started doing tutoring with the Chinese exchange students who were living at their house. He got pretty good at it and continued to tutor with them as they went back to China over Skype. And so he's now actually fluent in Chinese. And so I think it's this interesting, so technology is kind of creating some new opportunities for us, both in terms of that we can fly around the world now and then pursue relationships at very low or no cost over the internet. The other thing is that I did see this great thing that Microsoft did, whereas they actually do now, they're building the software to have real-time translation so that I could be sitting here speaking at this cadence and in real time on the screen behind me would be a translation and then have a voice for people who are on the earphone, which is just kind of mind-boggling. But so I think that may also be in our future as well.
Thank you. You have, as I said earlier, have covered so many topics that the questions would be prompting you anyway, and so I'd actually like to move forward to a really critical question, and that is, putting the rebalance aside for a moment, what do you think are the most critical components of your work with the Asia-Pacific region? And I'd like to fold this in with another question, and that is, what are the lessons, based on your experience, what are the lessons we need to take forward when we engage with the rebalance? Thank you. So to rephrase, putting the rebalance aside for a moment, what are the most critical components of your work with the Asia-Pacific region, and what lessons can we take forward?
Yeah, the Commerce houses the State Energy Office, in addition to several other functions, and so we have a state energy strategy that kind of looks at how we are going to meet our green, that kind of takes climate science seriously, and so we've got a real problem, as a state and as a globe, in terms of what we're with, human emissions of carbon in the atmosphere and how that's going to affect our climate and our world, and so I think, I think that is over the long term. I think anybody who's going to be, looking, sitting in the future 25 years from now, looking back and saying, what were they doing in 2013? What's the key issue that they were or weren't grappling with? It's not going to be the sequester.
Right.
It's going to be at what point did we finally start dealing with our carbon emission problem? And I think in the context of Asia, other air quality issues. So I think, that is just staring us square in the face, and it has all kinds of, it touches everything in terms of kind of, snowpack here, our fisheries, where we place infrastructure. And then certainly, I, by nature, an optimist, and so I think, solving those problems, coming up with clean energy sources, feeling out how we are going to adapt to the climate change that is already inevitable, I think is both a huge challenge. I mean, I think you can have a very dystopian view of the future where you have acidic oceans, you can't grow oysters, everything goes to hell in a handbasket, or we come together as a globe and start working on these problems. So I think that to me is just one that I think is long-term critical and that we've kind of have to circle around, and I remain optimistic that it can pull us together across the Asia-Pacific rather than tear us apart.
I'm out of order, so I apologize, but I'm going to build on Daniel's point. We have a tremendous amount of innovation happening in Washington State by small companies rethinking the way we do business for a low carbon economy. And there's a tremendous need and capital and ability to deploy that technology in Asia. But it's not straightforward. There's a lot of things that have to come into place in terms of government partnerships and better protection of intellectual property and better understanding. So I think I would completely agree that that is job number one for us, is to figure out a way to partner with Asia Pacific on the energy and the environment. But the job won't be complete until we agitate for national carbon legislation in this country, because we can't seriously have a dialogue with another country like China unless we get our own house in order.
Yeah, climate change, I think, is the biggest threat in beyond the rebalance. And many Asian countries are low-lying. Seas are rising now. And I will turn to the population of 230 million in Indonesia with 16,000 islands. The seas are rising, and the rainy season throughout Southeast Asia is longer. There are significant problems with the growing seasons now. The food insecurity is going to get worse. It's not just Southeast Asia, of course. This is around the world, and there will be more droughts in some places. There will be huge migrations of people. I'm talking about disasters. We need, in addition to the earthquakes and the typhoons and the tsunamis as the result of the earthquakes, many of these countries, especially Indonesia, are just sitting on these plates that are moving, and it's just a matter of look at your watch and decide, you know, when is the next earthquake, because it will happen in the next few hours. We do need to work with our Pacific neighbors in joining in an effort to respond to what will become significant population tragedies. And maybe it is too late already.
We talk about adaption and mitigation, right? So there's not some things we're going to have to adapt to, because
right.
We've already, you know,
we've gone too far.
But I think there's also, and so we need to get ready for that.
Absolutely.
But then we also can mitigate. I think we can't, you know, I remain an optimistic person.
I think do too.
There is a high value, low carbon economy in our future if we choose it. And I think that's our challenge and opportunity.
Right. However, I do think that we will see a more human tragedy, unfortunately. And I do think that we can respond to these disasters, as we've been talking about, in a collaborative way. For the good of people, mm-hmm. Our country, Washington State, and the people in Asia.
I'll take a little bit of a different track here. I from the security perspective, I talked early about our need to be able to fight and win our nation's wars, and so we have to be prepared to do that. And that also affects, if we have a force that's fully prepared, then that serves to act as a credible deterrent, so that in fact we can prevent conflict. But I would argue that in this theater, probably the most critical part of our work right now is on the shaping. It's really all about our relationships with others. And I'm going to take it a little bit of a deeper dive, because you asked what were some of the most important lessons that we can take forward. And this is one of those, I think, that we can draw heavily on what we've learned over a lot of engagement in Iraq and Afghanistan over the last 12 years, and apply it not just to the Asia-Pacific region, but everywhere else. And that's what we've learned about and continue to learn about the human domain. You know, if you look at a map of the Asia Pacific region, the first thing you notice is that there's a huge ocean there. Okay? It's huge. I mean, it sounds obvious, right? But there's a lot of blue on this map. and so people will tend to look from a military perspective, people from
from the Navy and the Air Force in particular will look at this map and say, there's a lot of blue there. But the issue is, guess what? The people don't live in the blue. They live on the brown and the green. And it's really about our relationships with people that count. And even when you look at it from a security perspective, even when we're facing an adversary, ultimately the question's about dealing with the adversary's will, which is fundamentally a human question. And so I'll just use my own experience in Iraq to talk about what I've learned over the last 10 or 12 years and how I think it applies to this. And that is that, you know, I think that early on we made a lot of mistakes in Iraq because we really didn't understand the Iraqi people. We didn't understand Arabic culture, let alone the subset that had been shaped by 35 years of Ba'ath Party rule, years of conflict between Arabs and Kurds, religious animosity between Sunni and Shia Arabs. And so we really didn't understand it. And it wasn't until we started trying to understand it that we got a lot more effective operating with the Iraqis, in this case, as partners. So one quick illustration. The military is very much a learning organization. We tend to be self-critical. And every time after every operation or every training event, we have what we call an after-action review. So we're going to sit down and look at all the things we did poorly. We try to look at the things we did well, but mostly we focus on the negative. What did we not do well, and how can we fix this next time around? We do this routinely. We do it so routinely that it's become a part of our culture on the military side. And so when something's part of your culture, it becomes an underlying assumption of how the organization operates. We don't even question it. So when we started dealing with training and advising the Iraqis, in my particular case, the Iraqi Special Police Commandos, the first thing we as Americans wanted to do after every combat operation was have an after-action review. Mm. What did we do well? What did we need to do better? And so you can't find an American platoon that will not be self-critical, will not hesitate to criticize their chain of command in an operation, but we encourage that because that's how we learn. But if you try to import that same model to an Iraqi platoon and you ask them, what do we need to work on, you're just going to get crickets chirping. Because their culture and their view of the commander as being all-knowing and all-powerful would not allow them to criticize their commander openly. And it wasn't really until we started understanding and seeing things through the Iraqis' eyes that we could get effective, we could help make our advising of them more effective. So what we started to do was we would pull the commander aside, sit down with three or four Americans, have a very frank dialogue, what do we need to do better? And we empowered the commander to go in and say, here's what we need to do better, this is what we did well. Thus reinforcing their own perception of him as being all-knowing and all-powerful. And we got, of course, a good training effect. We were blinded by our own perceptions that was framed in our own culture. So I think you have to be, in order to be effective, you have to be a student of culture. You have to start with your own culture to understand what your underlying assumptions are, and then work hard to understand the people from around the world and whoever you happen to be dealing with. And obviously, the people from Thailand are not the people from Cambodia. You know, are not the people from Laos, even though the languages may be very similar, especially between Laos and Thailand. They have a different culture, and if we don't understand that, shame on us. We won't be as effective working with them.
Thank you very much. We have time for two questions. Other questions from the audience, please.
My name is Jimmy Collins. I'm a resident of Steilacoom, among a number of other affiliations. In my experience, it's helpful to advance American interests, and Washington interests are a subset of that, by applying our effort across multiple domains. And for example, the acronym DIME is one that I've been trained on, where you talk about, or we plan and then integrate our activities in the diplomatic domain, in the informational domain, being transparent as an example of information, military, which by itself can be a fairly blunt instrument, but it's an important instrument to have in the quiver, and then economic, which really is the engine that fuels all the others. So I would just observe and then ask for comments from you on the panel. Events like the symposium help us to understand those multiple domains, but as we interact in Asia, whether it's in a specific country or in the theater as a whole, what can we do better to promote that sharing and integration of our activities so each element of means is helping reinforce our ability to advance our Washington and national interests?
I think one thing, I'll again take it from a military perspective, but I think a critical component for the military is to understand what the country team led by the ambassador, which is the president's representative in that country, what they want, and they are the ones to ensure unity of effort. We in the military play a role in it, but so does the Department of Commerce, Justice, Homeland Security, agriculture, on and on and on. And so from that's just ensuring unity of effort from a governmental perspective. And then, of course, we have other challenges when it goes to business and NGOs. Those are also opportunities as well.
I think speaking from the economic and business perspective, my 7 years in Asia and my last 15 years doing business related to Asia, that there's not enough exchange between the economic sphere and the military sphere, and that we don't understand as well as we could or should from the economic business perspective all the things the military is doing and their broader approach. And we could, with further understanding, I think we could be better ambassadors for the broad set of engagement that does take place between our country and other countries. So this has been a great first step for me in that learning.
I just want to echo that, and it's something, you know, as a leader in an enterprise, you know, I observe silos inside my own organization. You know, people get their heads down, they get focused on their work, and as a leader, part of my job is to try to help them get their heads up and understand the context in which they operate. And I think, and I try to do that at the level I operate, but I underinvest in some of these other important relationships, and I think that's why it's so great that you're bringing us together and having this conversation. And you need to have more of them, because it does kind of help foster the connections that kind of knit those things together in useful ways. But there is this tension, because people get busy, they get their heads down, and they work in their silo, and they need to pull their heads up and look around and realize they've got connections where they didn't think they did.
Thank you. Please go ahead.
Could I just have a last comment? Yeah. I really like the acronym DIME, but I would add an S and say DIMES, because I think there's something missing. And I think the S is the socio part. And it includes the NGO work, but it includes all those other social aspects of engagement. And so it's not just economic, it's socioeconomic. And so I'd say DIMES, or put an S in there somewhere. Thanks.
Thank you for that. Please go ahead.
My name's David Bergen. I'm just a citizen from Seattle. I wanted to ask the general if he could comment about the CIA's role in preparing reports and studies on instabilities in the world due to water, food shortage, and climate insecurity.
Thanks. I think one of the great impacts that we've had over the last 10 or 12 years of conflict on the positive side is actually improving not just our joint interdependence on the military side, but more importantly, interagency interdependence across all branches of the government. And the CIA and a number of other intelligence agencies all play a key role in that. And obviously, they give us a deep amount of background that our intelligence officers can draw on to help us better understand what the situation is in a given country or region.
And you can take any of the countries that we talked about as an example. And they tend to have experts there and spend a lot of time studying it. We don't limit our discussions and our understanding just on the CIA reports. We also go to USAID reports, you know, who happen to have a lot of long-standing relationships in these countries. Department of Agriculture really goes across the entire sphere of interagency cooperation. But I think that we have gotten much, much better at working across all sides of the government than we had been, say, 15 years ago.
Thank you. Please go ahead.
My name is Patsy Sir O'Connell from the Asia Pacific Cultural Center. We represent 47 countries of Asia Pacific, and we are here to interact Asian Pacific communities by bridging communities and generations through arts, culture, education, and business. I want to credit my husband's service to the Army for 30 years and moving 11 times to settle here in Washington to expose to myself as many different cultures and realizing how important it is for general public to know about what you all addressed. And my question is how to make more general public to be understanding about these different culture and why it's so important.
I've got a question for you. So as the leader of the Asia Pacific Cultural Center, what is your organization doing for this month, Asia Pacific Heritage Month? Anything in particular?
We have been invited by the schools and the judge, the organization where they have the lawyers, are interested in understanding about the different Asia Pacific cultures. Specifically, we are invited to the Bellingham Elementary School up there to supplement their studying about ocean, the countries in the ocean in Pacific Island, Pacific region. So we are sending five different Pacific Islanders culture to that school to educate. And also the lawyers group is interested in knowing the differences of Cambodia, Vietnam, and Laos. And that's another thing we will be involved in. And actually we have the cultural treasure trunk manager for the Asia Pacific Cultural Center is here, so she probably have a lot more information about what we are doing in month of May.
Thank you.
Well, thank you for all the work that you do. It's a really great question. I thought General Buchanan's comments on the cultural learning that he and his colleagues went through during the recent past was very helpful. I arrived in Beijing, China. I was 34. I was assigned as the president and CEO of Microsoft Greater China. I had never spent any time in China before, and I got zero training before I got there. And so I had to learn the lessons all the hard way. And I've made it a point now of thinking about it, documenting it, and giving classes on it. I'm doing a workshop in July. I think the basic, just like we look at other skills and capabilities in the way we teach children, in the way that we train university people, in the way we train people in the workforce, cross-cultural competency is something that is sorely lacking and is so fundamentally critical, not only in our dealing with people from other that live in other countries, but in our ability to get along and work well with each other. After I arrived back from 7 years in Asia with Microsoft and landed back in the corporate headquarters, and I saw this huge number of foreign-born employees working mainly, and this is a generalism, but working mainly for American managers, and I saw the gap and the gulf that existed between them, I was just so frustrated that we as an organization haven't thought about how to deal with that. So making cross-cultural competency and enabling people to thrive in a cross-cultural environment should be a core skill that we teach, we learn, we talk about all the time.
Thank you very much. Thank you for that question. And all of this is music to my ears as Director of Global Honors. The importance of cross-cultural competencies, and more importantly, global competencies, where you're really understanding context, it's absolutely vital. I also wanted to reinforce that as a university, that is our role, and we hope this is just one of many symposia on the topic where we bring the community together to talk about these very important issues. I'd like to thank very specially our panelists, Mr. Daniel Malarkey, General Buchanan, Dr. Beth Riven, and Mr. Michael Rodding. Thank you, audience. You've been wonderful. Your questions have really drawn out many layers of thought and experience from our distinguished panelists. We'd also like to thank our generous sponsors for this event. And here we have some take-home points that we are really at a moment of unprecedented development. We are accelerating partnerships. We're moving too fast. We're just moving so fast. It is bewildering. And so we need more moments like these to come together and discuss the implications for us as a local community and for our global engagement. As an academic, I'm really excited for my students, for the global lines of inquiry they will be able to develop, for the youth-inspired research they may embark on that is relevant to the communities we serve, for the jobs we need to prepare them for as we partner at all levels with the Asia Pacific. So thank you, panelists, for your rich and multifaceted picture that you've given us, for these multiple nodes of inquiry and action you've provided us to engage in this rebalance. I'd also like to say a special thank you to Dr. Lisa Hoffman for coordinating this event. And now I'm sure your heads are spinning with questions, comments, and you want just to have more dialogue. And so I'd like to invite you to the Columbia Bank lobby for refreshments and for more conversation. Thank you.